Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here. Praise the Lord, the living God. I keep trying to say I'm in the Philippines. I'm not in the Philippines right now. I'm not in Kansas anymore, brothers and sisters. And, I've been praying, and the Lord has been speaking to me about lots of things, brothers and sisters. And the last couple of days, I've been persistently feeling from the Lord that the time is short, which we know that. And then tonight, as I was praying, the Lord had just reminded me, those of you who have been following my channel for a while, besides the fact that I need a haircut. No, the Lord didn't tell me that. But I do need to get one. What can I do? Brothers and sisters, the Lord had reminded me of the commission he gave me when I started my YouTube channel. Just like the Lord had given me a commission when I started Joshua's ministry. When my stepson Joshua died, the Lord gave me a commission for Joshua's ministry, which was a little child shall lead them, and suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. But for the YouTube channel, the Lord really gave me a commission to be a fisher of men, to bring in the harvest and tell my people that I'm on my way. Tell my people that I'm on the way. And so those, when you say my people, those who are going to be saved also, brothers and sisters, God is outside of space and time. So when we talk about people being saved, you know, there's people that will be saved tomorrow that are already God's people in eternity. As the Bible says, we've been saved from the foundation of the world. So the Lord foreknew us. The Bible says, whom he foreknew, he did predestine, you know, to be conformed to the image of Christ. So the Lord foreknew that you would say yes to salvation. The Lord foreknew that you would say no to do an ABC. As an example, like myself, the Lord knew that foreknew that I would say yes to him. The Lord foreknew that I would go to the Philippines and that I would say yes to doing missionary work. But the Lord, you know, there's other things maybe that the Lord would have me do that he knows that I won't do. I don't know, brothers and sisters. We don't know everything. We don't know the past. We don't know the present. We don't know the future, you know, of what the Lord maybe has planned for us. So that's why it is the Lord's prerogative to set our destiny, to predestine us, to make a path for us to follow. And brothers and sisters, it's our job to find that path out, to seek that path out, brothers and sisters. And there's a proverb about that where it says that, you know, it's God's, you know, delight to conceal a matter and a king's joy to find it out. And so, brothers and sisters, the Lord had given me a text. I want to read this to you. What I'm trying to talk to you about tonight. And Jesus said this in Luke chapter 11, starting at verse 5. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto thee, though he shall will not rise and give him, but he and his, because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, which is his persistence, because of his persistence, he will rise and give as many as he needs. So you go to your friend's house in the middle of the night, and you keep banging on the door, hey, you know, can I borrow some bread because I've got some visitors here in the middle of the night. I don't have anything to feed them. Can you please, you know, loan me something to feed them? And Jesus is saying not because they're friends he gets up, because the guy just won't stop knocking. And I say, you know, and I want to talk about faith, and that's the topic. You know, that's my ministry since I started. The foundation of my ministry is faith. And that's how I was able to get to the Philippines and all this stuff was by faith. By faith, the Lord did it, and my part was faith, and that's our part in our relationship with the Lord. Even salvation is by faith. By grace, you're saved through faith. Let's see. And then the Lord goes on to say, and I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given unto you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. Him that seeketh, findeth. Him that knocketh, it shall be opened. If a son, listen to this. This is for all of you who are wondering about being filled with the Holy Spirit. People, you know, I've had people tell me, one reason why they might be afraid is because they think, well, it might be some demon or something or whatever, some strange spirit. Listen what Jesus continues to say here in this same text. Verse 11, Luke 11:11. And if a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will you give him a stone? Or if he asks for fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Now see, that's a good example. Serpent, you know, metaphorically, serpent, of course, is Satan or a demon. Or if he shall ask an egg, will you offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them who ask? Brothers and sisters, you know, I could keep on going on with that. Because it keeps going on and on. The same with another message. The Lord had told me to go to Luke 11. The next text is a whole other message I've done partly before. And I'm going to do again. Praise God. I'll make a video later on by the grace of God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so in this text, you know, lots of times in the faith movement, you know, so we as Christians, to be a Christian is to walk by faith and not by sight. You know, some people, you know, label, it's a common term, they label it word of faith movement. All things that we acquire from God is by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. There's nothing wrong with having faith and standing on the Word of God. That's how we get answered prayer. The reason why there's no miracles in most churches, why people aren't being healed and all that, is because they don't have any faith. They have a lack of faith. Jesus said at the end of Mark, the end of the Gospel of Mark, His final commission to the disciples, He said, "And these signs shall follow them that believe. In My name they'll cast out devils. They'll take up serpents and it won't hurt them. They'll drink, if they drink poison, it wouldn't hurt them. And they will speak with new tongues. They will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." Now what do the greasy gracers do? What do these old dead, you know, mainline Protestant denominations do? Talking about your Methodist, Presbyterian, all those guys, the ones who are really apostate already, all of them, almost 100%, they're all apostate. They deny the virgin birth. They deny who's Jesus. What do they say? They say that text was added later. They say that's not in the copy. And I'll say that again. Go watch the video. There's a copy of the documentary on YouTube, Tares Among Wheat by Chris Pinto. He has a second one, Tares Among Wheat, and the other one I forgot, but it's a part two of that. Anyway, it's about these modern translations of the Bible, brothers and sisters. How the alleged ancient manuscripts were found in the 1800s. It was really, it's a fact. This stuff was planted. It's not really ancient. And then they omit those texts that talk about the Son of God. Anything that exalts Jesus, about the blood of Jesus and this kind of stuff, those and this text are missing from these new manuscripts they found that are supposed to be so ancient. It mysteriously omits the most powerful text in the Bible, brothers and sisters. Flee from those translations that are used from those texts that were found in the 1800s. You can use a modern translation if it's translated from the Sola Scriptorium, there's a repository of the Scriptures prior to those days before the 1800s, like where the King James comes from. Now, if someone made a modern translation, and they were serious Christians, not some... The problem with the modern translation, besides the bad text, is also the scholars, like the NIV. I'm getting off topic. The NIV. There's a brother. His name is Chambers. He has a church in Charlotte, North Carolina, and then he has a podcast. And he interviewed a woman that was an English professor scholar for the NIV. And she is a lesbian, and she's an atheist. And she got on board, she got herself on the committee to help make the NIV for the sole purpose of trying to take away and make Christianity of no effect. That's her whole meaning and purpose in life. She admitted that. He interviewed her and asked her about it. You know, she wants to say that God is also a woman. She wants to water it down, the masculinity of God. That was her whole life revolves around that. That was her mission in life. She was on the committee for the NIV. Lots of them are like, that's the problem with most modern translations. The people that wrote the King James were very devout, serious, born-again Christians who had just coming out of the tyranny of Roman Catholicism. And they were zealous to bring the Word of God to the people and give us the age, the real age of enlightenment. Enlightenment is not the light of Lucifer from Masonry and the you know, Sir Francis Bacon and the Rosicrucians and all those who thought they brought us enlightenment. The real dark ages was when the Bible was hidden from the world by the Roman Catholic Church. And the real age of enlightenment, the real Renaissance, is the time when the Geneva Bible came out and all those translations, and Martin Luther translated his Bible. God brought a Renaissance, a revival of the Word first, and then the spiritual revivals came, the Great Awakening in the United States and all that. The Lord's given me kind of a whole nother message. Let me go back to where I was at. So back where I was at, brothers and sisters, we need faith. And that's what Jesus is saying in this Luke chapter 11, that we must continue. And what I was going to say, you know me, brothers, you know how I operate. If you watch my videos, what I was going to say is in the Word of Faith movement, they will say that, you know, you pray one time and then you don't pray again because you believe, you're standing by faith, that it's already been answered and you don't have to pray again. Now that's a valid human point. But Jesus said, and he gives a parable. He says that the guy gets up and answers the door and gives the guy what he's asking, not because he's his friend, not because you're a Christian, but because of your persistence. Your persistence. So yes, we ask, we seek, we knock, and we keep on asking, seeking, and knocking, and declaring, you know, that the Lord's answer is on the way. That's a statement of faith. Now that's what the Word of Faith movement is really all about, brothers and sisters, is saying, God promises that by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. So I ask the Lord, as an example, I've got something wrong, someone, like a brother, and I ask you to pray for Brother Gary, Bear049, who has a YouTube channel out there. He's got a problem with his knee. And I ask you to pray for his knee to be healed. I ask you to pray for his liver to be healed. I ask you to pray for his, he has a tooth that's cracked. I ask you to pray that his tooth will be repaired by God, supernaturally. Or he will have the finances to come in to go to the dentist. Either way, God will make a way for him, as an example. So the Bible says, by the stripes of Jesus, we were healed. In Isaiah, it says, in the Old Testament, it says, by his stripes, we are healed. Isaiah 53. In the New Testament, it says, 2 Peter 2:24, it quotes that and it says, by his stripes, we were healed. Past tense, at the cross. At the cross where I first saw the light. By his stripes, we were healed. When the Lord received our stripes, 40 save one for us. 39 stripes, the Lord, that's the Roman tradition. So, brothers and sisters, your old people who have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, those old dead religious people will say, oh, it means you're spiritually healed. No, we're that's also in it. That's the whole thing about the word salvation, as I talked about before. I talked about doing a video about that. That in the word salvation is healing, deliverance, forgiveness, all of those things are included. You know, that's the message that the Lord, last night when I was about to go to sleep, the Lord gave me a message that ties in with this. I guess I should make it one message. Maybe I should make it a separate message. You know, my videos are so long. But anyway, last night, this is what the Lord spoke to me when I was getting ready to go to sleep. He's just, thank the Lord that, you know, God will just, you know, speak to you. If you seek him, ask and knock, he will speak to you. And the Lord, you know, and then I'm a preacher, so the Lord spoke to me, something to tell you guys. So I was laying there, and the Lord said, you know, there was a man that carried his own, that they carried him in on a mat, and it's in Luke, Matthew, it's in several of the Gospels, but it's in Matthew at the time that Jesus meets Matthew, who's Levi, the tax collector. His Greek name is Matthew. I believe that's going to be in Matthew chapter 9, if I remember correctly. So, right before, you know, Matthew was there observing, and then the Lord called him while he was watching there. And so they brought this man on a mat, and then Jesus said to the guy, be of good cheer, your sins are forgiven thee. Your sins are forgiven thee. Okay, I hope that all of you greasy gracers and all of you dead denominational people, from Baptist to the liberal and the liberal, beyond that, Presbyterians, Methodists, all the above, will you listen to what I'm telling you, wisdom from the Most High God? So that God equates physical healing with spiritual healing, with salvation, as part of salvation. So Jesus said, be of good cheer. Son, you know, son, be of good cheer. Thy sins are forgiven thee. And then the Pharisees, those old religious leaders, just like the religious leaders today, they said, who is this guy to try to forgive somebody's sins? Only God can forgive somebody's sins. Oh, those religious people, those tares among the wheat, those children of the devil, their father the devil, as Jesus said, he was a liar and the father thereof, and they do just like their father. They are liars and murderers. So those old liars and murderers were there, and they said, who is this guy that thinks he can forgive sins? Only God can forgive sins. And then Jesus turned to the man that was lying on the mat, and he said to him, you know, he said, so that people will know that the Son of Man himself has authority to forgive sins on earth, arise, take up your mat, and go home. So he physically healed the guy. Physical healing is the proof that Jesus has the power to forgive sins. Now, another thing that those people who are tares and denier of the faith and have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, they would say, well, that was only in the life of Jesus. You know, Jesus was confirming himself by signs and wonders. Well, number one, if I hand this Bible to a non-believer and walk down the street and say, here, read what Jesus did 2,000 years ago, they can easily say to me, well, that's just a book. That's just a story. That's a fairy tale. That doesn't mean nothing. We got doctors today. We got antibiotics. People are living to be 80 years old plus. Young people might expect to live to be 100, 150, they say. Why would they need this old book? Why do they need to find out about Jesus who was, the great I was? They don't need to meet Jesus the I was. They need to meet the Jesus I am. I am the God who healeth thee. I am Jehovah Jireh. I am the God that provides. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am, not I was, I am. Jesus said to, you know, the Apostle Paul told us as he was working for the Lord that he became all things to all people. He became Christ to them and presented them and let them meet Christ. As Paul says in 2 Corinthians, we are to be ambassadors of Christ. Now, what does that mean? You know, it says that we're supposed to be a sweet-smelling savor to those who are inherit eternal life, to those being saved. But, you know, a stench in the nostril of those who are lost and do not want to be saved. Brothers and sisters, we as ambassadors are to introduce people to the great I am, not the great I was. That's what I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters. That's the summation of the ministry that God gave me. You are presenting people with religion. You are presenting people with religion and of the past. Denominations, what God, you know, God did a move and they came up with a, like I mention all the time, John Wesley. God did a move back in those days in the 1700s and brought about, you know, a new denomination, the Methodist denomination. It was holiness and on fire. But God did that 300 years ago, 250 years ago. Today is a day of salvation. God is the I am, not the I was. That's why when I talked about people who operate, every famous preacher that operates in signs and wonders, there are those who say it's from the devil. Just like they did in the time of Jesus, just like they did in the time of the apostles, people don't want the power of God. They want somebody that's a people-pleasing, smiling in their face. They don't want any preacher that operates in signs and wonders. There are people who talk lie, the devil's children, you know, make videos and documentaries and TV. The world makes TV specials about them, you know, looking for anything they can find and making up stuff about people. Because the devil hates the power of the Holy Spirit. Why do you think there's such controversy in the church about speaking in tongues, even though it's in the Bible? Why do you think that is? The devil can't stand the gifts of the Spirit. Of course not, because it brings an end to his kingdom. As Jesus said in this next text that I'm going to make another video about. Jesus said, if I cast out devils, because they accused him of casting out devils by Beelzebub, just like this message I'm talking about. They said he was doing it by the power of demons, by the power of Satan. Beelzebub, Lord of the flies. And then, you know, everybody wants to get caught up in the unforgivable sin. This is the point that you need to get today. Jesus said, if I cast out demons by the finger of God, know that the kingdom of heaven has come near you. The kingdom of heaven has come near you. That's why the devil and his people, they hate the gifts of the Spirit, because it is signs and wonders to follow. These signs and wonders shall follow them that believe. So ask yourself, instead of sitting around criticizing and accusing men of God that they're being used of the devil when they're using the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're praying for people, millions and thousands and millions of people getting saved from the true gospel, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, rose on the third day, all of the gospel message. yet signs and wonders are following them. You may think they're fake because you're not there. You're judging all those thousands of people, millions of people. You're judging all of them that they're all paid, they're all fake. All the people that got saved, you know, what signs and wonders are following you? The Bible says for us to not judge others, but judge yourself to see if you be in the faith. You know, people talk about, you know, someone can have 99% truth and 1% deception. Look, people are not perfect. There is no perfect person, brothers and sisters. No perfect man. No human will ever be perfect. But the message that they give, or the gospel, is what God is concerned with. And he follows that with signs and wonders. Paul wasn't perfect. By no means. He said he was the chief among sinners. He got in arguments with Barnabas so bad that they stopped speaking to each other and went their separate ways. Because they fought over if they were going to take Barnabas' nephew with them on a trip. John Mark. The one who wrote the gospel of Mark. As he dictated the words from the apostle Peter. Most of you guys, you think you want to major in all these things, but don't know the basics of the Word of God. The book of Mark was the first gospel written, and it was the oral words of Peter written down by John Mark, who is the nephew of Barnabas, who was also ran naked. In the gospel of Mark, you will see there was a young man who ran naked from the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus was arrested. That's also John Mark, same guy. Okay. And also the house where they had the upper room where the Pentecostal came and the Holy Spirit fell. It's also his mama's house. So, brothers and sisters, there's many, many things to know about the Word of God. But you know what? All of that is not really important. People need to know the Lord as the great I am today. Not all of those things that I just mentioned will not get you across the street from your house to know those things that I just said. It is not nearly, is it nothing to knowing the gospel and knowing Jesus, personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. A personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I just want to add this on here. As I mentioned, there is a man. Let's just use an example of a man. Nobody's perfect. There's a man who has led millions of people to the Lord. He's preached over 200 million people. This man has got, there's at least two videos on YouTube where this man says that Jesus is not the only way to heaven. There are people who die from every religion who will go to heaven and they just don't know it and they, you know, they're not, don't have to be born again. Said it on Larry King Live and he said it on the Hour of Power with Robert Schuller, the Crystal Cathedral guy who's now retired. He said it on there. This man is a 33rd degree Mason. This man has personal friendships with the world's most elite Illuminati evil people, and they didn't get saved. Almost none of them ever got saved. That he spent hours and hours hanging out with in leisure activities like golfing. But this man, I still say this man is a man of God. He's led over 200 million people to the Lord, and he also has the error of saying when you get saved, you're baptized in the Holy Spirit. But yet this man, I say, is a servant of God. And has done much work for the Lord, has many crowns in heaven. And that man is Billy Graham. But he has all of those shortcomings that are publicly known, public mistakes, and public things. He's only a man. But yet he's loved, even by the world loves him, which actually is on the negative list. Because Jesus said, you know, the world hateth me, it'll hate you also. You know, no servant is above his master. You know, they hated me, they'll hate you also. So all of those reasons someone could say, oh, there's deception there. This guy's wicked. He's this, that, and the other. But no one does that because it's not politically correct to say something about Billy Graham because the world loves him. But I'm not saying anything. I'm telling you that he's a human. He's a man. And he's made his mistakes like anybody else, whatever they may be, brothers and sisters. So I asked you to look at to know the Lord as the I am today in your life, your personal relationship. And ask the Lord and seek the Lord and knock and ask the Lord and say to the Lord, you want signs and wonders to follow you in your life. And stop worrying about what everybody else is doing and judging all these people who are being used by God. Because the things of the Spirit, you're judging by the carnal mind, not by the Spirit. Those are the things of the Spirit are foolishness to man. So when we see people, you know, under the power of the Holy Spirit, we think it's foolishness. Next time we know, say it's a demon. Same thing they said to Jesus when he was healing people. Oh, he's casting out demons by Beelzebub. We need to all humble ourselves. We need to humble ourselves, brothers and sisters. I'm not fearing anything, brothers and sisters. Any time I've ever have a lack of faith about a vehicle and all that stuff, you know, we all have our shortcomings in our lives. We all, you know, have our periods of a dry season. Our brothers and sisters, the Lord is with His people. He said He'd never leave us nor forsake us. He'll make a way for me. He'll make a way for you. If you're a Christian, if you're a child of God, He'll make a way for you. If God be for you, who can be against you? Put your faith and trust in the Lord and seek, ask, and knock, and He'll make a way for you, brothers and sisters. God bless you guys.